Welcome, everyone. My name is Dana White, and we are extremely privileged tonight to have a very special myth salon, a little bit out of the ordinary. It comes on the heels of not only some perhaps leveling off of the coronavirus, but we finally have turned the corner on a really problematic administration leading or not leading the country. And as troubling as it was last week, we really seem to have a future ahead of us for the first time in quite some time. But the coronavirus lingers. We have 25 million cases in the United States, 430 some odd thousand deaths, 4,000 a day. And this is a tragedy beyond measure. It does appear with the vaccinations on the way that this new administration is really taking hold of the situation in a mindful, responsible way. And so I really hope that people will continue to give support to masking and social distancing, and that we can put this thing behind us and get back to some sort of a sense of community. I would also like all of us to hold in our moment of silence. Forrest's mom had a stroke. And so Forrest is not with us tonight. And I just can't say enough about my friendship with Forrest and his participation in the Myth Salon. But let's have ourselves a moment of silence. And that is my wife and dog just coming in.
Sorry.
So she says, sorry, but that's all right. You know, this is a public forum. We all have things that happen and we have lives that we are leading. What a beautiful myth salon we're in store for. I'm gonna depart a little bit from our normal format, and I just want to introduce a very special guest tonight. In addition to Dr. Ron Schenk, I reached out to Diane Sherwood on the Splendor Solis. I want to introduce her by saying that Diane did her analytic training at the Jung Institute in San Francisco. For 10 years, she served as editor of the Jung Journal, Culture and Psyche. And in 2010, she moved to Oberlin, where she has a private practice, and she lectures and consults. And the key to the whole thing that started everything happening is this beautiful book called Transformation of the Psyche. And published in 2003. In 2004, she was offering with Jacques Rutsky a workshop in Northern California. And I was really looking forward to going to this. I've been a fan of the Splendor Solis probably for 5 or 10 years before that. Something came up, you know how workshops are. And I thought that, okay, she'll give it again. I kept waiting, never showed up, didn't happen. I went, but I use it as the bookmark in my book. And I just had the sense when Ron said he was going to come into the Myth Salon that, well, he's doing it on the Splendor Solis. I'm gonna email her and just let her know that we're doing it. I thought that would be pretty cool. Maybe she'd like to watch it. So we started emailing back and forth, and the next thing I know, she was more than a little enthusiastic about it and agreed to come on with us. I can't tell you how excited I am to have this collection of scholars and people surrounding us on this immensely valuable alchemical publication, or whatever you want to call it. I mean, it's just it's just, this is really cool. I would also say that Diane told me that they didn't hold the workshop because apparently they didn't get enough people. So maybe if I'd have gone, there would have been enough people. I'd have drug a few people. But we're talking about the possibility of doing a symposium or a conference. And I now know a lot of people about the Splendor Solis, and I think we have the makings of an event. So with that in mind, I'm going to turn it over now to my very good friend, Will Lynn, who I can't, again, say enough about this fellow. I mean, without him, there's no Myth Salon. You don't get me out here doing this thing. I am just so grateful to Will for his partnership in this and for the two of us together with Dr. Connie Zweig, tracking down people. I mean, you know, Connie is she's a tracker. She's a bloodhound. And she just gets people and brings them in and is trying to get me to be more organized than I ever had a hope of being. And I'm extremely grateful to Connie for her generosity of spirit and the quality of friendship she has brought into all of this. It's just an immensely satisfying community.
Never been called a bloodhound before.
Well, it won't be the last. So, Will, why don't you make the rounds and let's let people know who's in here. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dana. and thank you also, Connie. You know, we've done some pretty awesome events before on alchemy and the Myth Salon and the Soul's Journey in the past. And I think of the salon with Charles Zeltzer was really a phenomenal night. And I think of the recent alchemy exhibit at the Getty that I think most of us went to and came back and talked about together in Dana's living room before COVID drove us all into our own living rooms. For those of you who are depth psychologists and mythologists, you know how central alchemy is and was to the development of Jungian psychology and the study of symbolism and dream imagery and archetype and individuation, and ultimately the hero's journey, or even Eliot's work with Eternal Return. But for those of you new to the material, especially screenwriters that might be with us tonight, you're in for a real treat. This is integral, deep, deep programming, layers deep by the time you're getting to conversations like story brand or hero's journey or things like this that are more consumable. Layers and layers deep into the dream imagery and into the alchemy. This is where we're going tonight. Alchemists were storytellers. They just told their stories with matter. Their narratives were processes. But the goals were the same, the transmutation of the human spirit or the transformation of psyche. Tonight's gonna be very special. So I wanna thank all of our panelists who I'd now like to introduce. You know Dana White, scholar, author, host of the Myth Salon and adjunct faculty member at Pacifica Graduate Institute. And I'd like to thank him for introducing Diane Sherwood already tonight. My name is Will Lynn. I lightly moderate these Myth Salons. My PhD is in myth from Pacifica. I've spent years working for the Joseph Campbell Foundation and built an academic department for filmmakers and performing artists at what's now called Hushon College. We're also joined by Dr. Dennis Patrick Slattery, a mythology scholar, poet, longtime professor in Pacifica's myth program, and author of An Obscure Order, Reflections of on Cultural Mythologies. We're joined also by Selena Matthews, a clinical psychologist, author, and keynote speaker who graduated from Pacifica and has been an ever-present participant and supporter of the Myth Salon with us. Zaman Stanazai is a professor of mythology and political science at Pacifica and Cal State, poet, linguist, mystic, and Fulbright scholar, expert on Middle Eastern politics. Sophie Defresny is an artist specializing in illustration, painting, graphic design, and animation who markets and sells products with their own designs under the name Sophie Key. And I hope that AJ will share some of these references with y'all in the chat, and we'll continue to make sure we're pointing y'all to anything referenced or mentioned tonight in the chat. So keep your eye down there. I met Sophie when the Jung certification was going on through the Jung Institute. And many of our friends, as well as Boris, we got to know through that. I'd also like to thank and welcome Connie Zweig, who helps us invite so many amazing guests, as Dana mentioned. Connie's an internationally renowned psychologist for her work on shadow, whose books include Meeting the Shadow and Romancing the Shadow. Dr. Elizabeth Ewan Nelson is with us tonight. Thank you for joining us. Is a professor at Pacifica Graduate Institute. Her books include The Art of Inquiry, A Depth Psychological Perspective, Psyche's Knife, Archetypal Explorations of Love and Power, and the forthcoming Shadow Vows and Love, Work and the Art of Life. Dr. Nelson also guides writers from inspiration to publication. And finally, our guest of the evening, Ronald Schenk, Jungian analyst, is currently in private practice in Dallas and Houston, and his interests are in clinical thought, cultural psychology, postmodernism, and the interface of the arts with depth psychology. He's a senior training analyst and president for the Council of North American Societies of Jungian Analysis, and he's written 4 books, most recently American Soul and several essays in Jungian publications. Tonight's going to be a very special evening. I know that this is going to be a little bit more of a show than a typical salon, so I hope y'all are all comfortable where you are. And with that, I'd like to welcome in Ron. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Thank you all, everyone. This is a real delight to be here with you all of the participants that are coming in tonight. This is, as Dana mentioned, we are living as we speak in a tumultuous time in our culture, a tremendously psychological time, I would say. So we might be wondering, you know, how can we be talking about myth in, you know, in the midst of all that's going on right now? But what I hope is comes out of tonight is that we can never talk about myth because we are always living within myth. Myth has us. And I hope that, and so I want to make references to not only daily life, but to our present cultural scene as we go through these mythical images, and to show how myth is informing, always is informing our individual life and cultural life at every moment. And so what the best that we can do then is to describe the experience. We're not going to be talking about myth, but we're going to be living within myth as best we can and describing the experience. The mode of presentation is going to be that I'll be showing, talking in terms of 11 archetypal spaces that occur in the Splendor Solis mythology. Archetypal spaces. And what is really interesting to me about the Splendor Solis is that they show a center alchemical image, but then around the periphery of the image, there are always small details of everyday life that are informed by the archetype, so that we'll get a real sense of within the imagery of the Splendor Solis itself, how myth and everyday life are interrelate with each other. Now, these chronological or these conditions we'll be talking about, what we want to do is to see that normally from our ego standpoint is to see them in terms of a story, beginning, middle, and end. But psychologically speaking, that's not how it works, that archetypal conditions appear of their own. And are evoked of their on their own, so that we can't really think of them as being, well, that this is what comes first, and then this is what comes second, and this is what comes after that, because as well, they are always multiple. Each condition is always being interfaced with another condition. There are multiple conditions, multiple archetypal conditions all converging at one time, can happen. So that gives you a brief overview of how we're going to be going about things. I did want to make some beginning remarks about the technological aspect of our presentation. Normally, I give this presentation live. And when I do, I do the singing that you will be hearing from, fortunately, from a Metropolitan Opera star, Bryn Terfel. And I also have a tap dancer and a piano accompaniment. So the whole thing is kind of an encircling event. But we have a different technological mode now in our culture. And when there's technology, there are always glitches that occur. And so I'm anticipating that happening tonight. And my approach to that, again, is that technological glitches are psychological events. They have their meaning to them. So that, for example, if I need to come back in and my face is shown while I'm trying to get back on the slide, that will be just in reminding us that there is a narrator, there's an author, a single personality behind this. And this is simply one perspective, not necessarily the perspective of any quote authority unquote, but one single perspective. Also, we'll be hearing the voice of T.S. Eliot. It will be sounding grainy, but that grainy sound takes us back to the time of Eliot. And it reminds us that Eliot is like a ghost, a spirit that's informing us. He's not a present personality coming through with voice that is technologically perfect. It will also take us back to the time of Eliot and bring back associations to what was going on during that time that he wrote. They also might detect slight delays in the videos of opera arias between the sound of the voice and the movement of the face. But again, psychologically, that would just indicate there's always a gap between intention and manifestation. That was the first introduction. Now we go into the second introduction, which is the part of the program itself. So I will now attempt to get us going here, launched on the journey, so to speak. This is Hermes guiding the arrow that won't go where it's supposed to. The soul's trip, the journey that is not a journey. A major aspect of Jung's quest was to find a language appropriate to the complexity of the psyche. He found this in myth, its sense of story, and through alchemy in its sense of process and paradox, and in both through the notion of image. For Jung, image was a realm with a life of its own, encompassing the rational and irrational, spirit and matter, while embracing and integrating elements of several seemingly disparate disciplines, including science and religion, literature and philosophy, anthropology and art, music and myth. Image itself holds meaning, while at the same time providing a venue for understanding through experience. Image is a world unto itself, in which we are always already ensconced, and through which we are conscious. Today's program will attempt to extend Jung's sense of image as the basic language of the psyche through a multimedia, multidisciplinary event based on the theme, the soul's journey from Gnostic mythology. The narrative in Gnostic myth is the story of the soul's being in the world as one of fall, search, and homecoming, with journey as the soul's perpetual throwing out of images in which to enter as the next step. In essence, it is a depiction of the process of psychological transformation. Okay, but as a matter of the way of the psyche, change is always paradoxical, always within sameness. The sameness is the universality which is held in mythic and archetypal image. The particular transformation that we'll be going into tonight ultimately culminates in a recognition of self as part of an embodiment of other, self and other, now relative terms, perpetually interpenetrating each other, each always indefinable, because always determined, by an interactive field of interrelationship of multiple entities. Whatever we encounter as other is always already a part of us. In a larger sense, we might say that the soul comes to recognize itself as a matter of imagination, an emergence of paradoxical interaction of internal and external, spirit and matter, abstract and concrete, personal and transcendent, conscious and unconscious, like the Renaissance fantasy of the circle as a fluid of uncertainty, the center of which is everywhere and the circumference nowhere. Our presentation will investigate 11 aspects of the process of change that are archetypal, that is, conditions or metaphorical places appearing in similar circumstances across time and culture, depicting what is seen and experienced, and at the same time, a way of seeing. Each archetypal space has both beneficent and maleficent effects, conveying both light and dark connotations, but light and dark relative to perspective. The redeemer from one stance is Satan from another, but then again, the etymological root of Satan is light bringer. And that notion of the archetypal image is relative in the perspective, I think, is right there in our culture. For some of us, what happened in the election and what has happened with the inauguration is a sigh of relief. For others, it's a point of day, it's an experience of despair. Lastly, each archetypal space is constantly interfacing with other universal systems, as well as always influencing and being influenced by events of everyday life, situations close at hand. Archetypes and myths are worlds co-created by multiple interrelated agencies. To illustrate them, we will be using images from art and from alchemy, and an ancient tradition of imagination, interweaving philosophy and practice, procedure and belief, experience and theory, fantasy and reason, kitchen and library. Alchemy deals fundamentally with bringing about the transformation of gross matter into its essential form. What is represented as a journey in myth, indicating any going on event of change, is seen by alchemy as a hands-on work in process toward an essential but ultimately unattainable goal. The work of alchemy is in bringing about change through various procedures, often held as secrets, which carry their own paradoxical intentions. We will be using the alchemical imagery from the Renaissance text, Splendor Solis, telling the quest of a pilgrim for the mysterious revelations of alchemy. And here I'd like to add to kind of the congratulations given to Diane Sherwood, because she, tremendously generous of heart, gave me the images from her book to use in this in my presentation. And not only did she work for 10 years on the San Francisco Journal, but she is now working on the Interregional Society Network newspaper and doing a tremendous job with that, bringing a life to something that would ordinarily be just kind of passed off. So thank you, Diane. Rather, finally, remember that journey in Gnostic myth and process in alchemy are analogous metaphors and are not images of a linear progress. Rather, they are images or worlds of the depth of experience in the moment, with all of its ramifications, which can and do appear outside of any chronological sequencing or triumph of achievement. A psychological narrative accompanies the images, as well as selections from T.S. Eliot's Meditations on Time, the Four Quartets, consisting of four poems: Burnt Norton, East Coker, Dry Salvages, and Little Gitting, combining metaphors of journey with alchemical themes in relation to imaginal place and time. Musical pieces and art songs, as well as arias from operas recorded on video, will round out the presentation so that the ideas will be presented in music itself and words will be heard as images. Our attempt is to integrate what is usually considered in separate categories and show their interface between the transcendent and personal, education and art, poetry and presentation, lecture and song, entertainment and understanding, a paradoxical space that is the essence of psychological reality. The presentation is modeled in part upon the German composer Richard Wagner's notion of the total work of art, and we'll have several selections from Wagner's operas, and upon the ceremonial healing rituals of Navajo Native Americans, wherein the quote singer unquote relates mythical narratives through chants while the patient sits on sand paintings created by the singer, and dancers in the aspect of gods perform outside the hut as container. With the Navajo, what the Western mind considers as separate phenomena of medicine and art, religion, music, storytelling, performance, and education are all combined into one community gathering in service to healing. We might imagine that the healing project of our inquiry tonight is to be in the repair of our rational mind, which is it diminishes the sense of the integrated world held by imagination. Okay, that's the end of the second introduction. So now we launch off. We're out of the harbor now. We're out on the sea, and we will launch off into our first condition. The call. An image emerges, indicating a form of dialogue between two suns, one above, glowing and radiant, the other below, sick, dilapidated, trapped, and topsy-turvy. This connection is backed by a conversation between two men outside the city walls, as if separated from customary discourse. The frame is interlaced with birds, a monkey in song and another eating, indicating the interaction between performance and nurturance, and the words, the arms of the art, indicating the power of a creative force at work in the world. In this image, we can imagine the gleaming sun calling to his counterpart below in distress and dis-ease. King and queen reveal outward oppositions, and their call to each other in the external world is also the counterpart secretly held within, the other outside, always in complement to an interior concealment. The queen, standing on a dark full moon or a rotation, is calm, holding a scroll that reads Milk of the Virgin, a form of prima materia or first matter, while the king, standing on fire, is somewhat disheveled and agitated, holding a scroll reading Coagulate the Masculine, or we might simply say, get it together, guy. The two scrolls are indicative of a beginning process, and together give rise to the alchemical dictum, dissolve and coagulate, each process evoking the other, signifying a central dynamic in the process. The phrase at the bottom of the frame could be read as, through the particular to the universal and back, which is the mode of archetypal life. In Gnostic mythology, the soul, descended from the spiritual heavens, inevitably falls asleep in the netherworld of materiality, becomes numb with pain, confused and disoriented, lost amidst the noise of the world, a stranger or sojourner in a strange land, with life a perpetual sleepwalk. A counterpart of divine spark is aroused in the heavens and descends as if attracted to awaken its other in the hile below. The ensuing call, the unknown penetrating the fortress of the known, takes many forms. A sudden memory or surprising realization, a strange voice or a gnawing from within, a song of love, a glitch or mistake, a smear or a slip or a jolt, or a grand catastrophe, or disaster, a missile from the other side of the world, or from the other side of the bedroom, or a letter, or a thorn, or a thistle. In myth, the cry of a bird, or in dreams, the appearance of and confrontation with an intrusive, often frightening figure. The call is the trumpet of the apocalypse, the call of the clarion, the toll of the bell, someone knocking at the door, the alarm of the bedside clock, the voice in the wilderness, the burning bush or the burning toast, the smell of coffee, an injury or a sickness, the call of the wild or the pull of creature comfort, a glimpse of potential or the prick of necessity, a gentle push or a great shove, a small surprise or a grand revelation, a crack in the glass, or an explosion, or the perpetual harping of the furies of guilt torturing Orestes. Anything that creates an opening or awakening or an edge is the call from without, heard or unheard or ignored, responded to or resisted, the spark of truth or a false alarm, or the trump pet call of the blowhard, spouting nothing but hot air, but to an audience that is in concealed fire that is set aflame with the hot air. T.S. Eliot, the Burnt Norton, Burnt Norton. Footfalls echo in the memory, down the passage which we did not take, towards the door we never opened, into the rose garden. My words echo thus in your mind, but to what purpose, disturbing the dust on a bowl of rose leaves? I do not know. Other echoes inhabit the garden. Shall we follow? Quick, said the bird, find them, round the corner. Through the first gate, into our first world, shall we follow the deception of the thrush? Into our first world, there they were, dignified, invisible, moving without pressure over the dead leaves in the autumn heat, through the vibrant air, and the bird called in response to the unheard music hidden in the shrubbery, and the unseen eye beam crossed.
Oh, mistress mine, where are you roaming? Oh, stay and hear your true love's coming. That can sing both high and low. Trip no farther, pretty sweetie. Journeys end in lovers' meeting. Every wise man's son doth know. Hereafter, praise present mirth, a present laughter, once the palm is still unsure. In delay there lies no plenty. Then come kiss me sweet and twenty. Youth's a staff will a lover and his loves, with the hay and the hoe and the hay on me know. That o'er the green cornfield did pass in springtime, the only pretty ring time, when birds do sing, hey ding a ding a ding, sweet lovers love. Folks would lie in springtime, the only pretty ring time, when birds do sing, hey ding a ding a ding, sweet lovers love the spring. This carol they began that hour, with a hey and a ho and a hey.
The fall into desire. The call is often connected with a fall. A youth nurtures a dragon while billowing an invisible fire within the dragon, a process of simultaneously dissolving and heating up the calcified condition. Surrounding scenes from everyday life depict fallen situations, water draining into the ground, the terminus of a river, a funeral, a grave being dug, a hanging, beatings, while pigs are caught, killed, and butchered, all under the aegis of Hermes, god of the ups and downs of the journey, windfalls and losses, thieves and guides, from his chariot above. The dark sun, soul Niger, sinks into the burned and dried out earth. The fall is the condition of the soul, inevitably and necessarily fallen away from alignment with the path staked out by spirit above. Desire leads to craving and greed, singular identification with attachment to power and pleasure. The fall is the crawl of Nebuchadnezzar. The psychological condition may become saturnine, stuck to ego orientation, single-mindedness, literalism's action at all cost, unilateralism, extremism, possession, intoxication, obliviousness, compulsion, alienation, resulting in power plays. Life becomes toned by bitterness, futile repetition, and useless suffering without awareness, all symbolized alchemically in the dragon's descent into the vase. The center has been lost. The only sanity found in the storm of madness is out on the heath. And the arch-villain Edmund from Shakespeare's King Lear sums up the condition when he declares, "Now, gods, stand up for bastards." Or the fall is the fall of the ousted, desperate tyrant. Or consciousness has become too airy and the need is for descent to materialization. The fall is falling asleep in bed or at the wheel or into a sleepwalk or simply forgetting, or the soul cast out into a composite world of homogeneity, suddenly becoming vulnerable, naked, or it can be the descent of the soul in desire for coupling, falling in love, giving over to the hard work of relationship, or the dove descending or disintegrating, the mundane state tumbling down the rabbit hole into complexity, or the singular ideal rocking off the high horse into materiality or mortality, spiritual purity mixing it up with the money changers, coming down to earth, getting real, getting down, the hands dirtied, the toe wet, the necessary hitting the bottom. It can be the beginning as it was with Adam, or it is the end as Hamlet shows. There's special providence in the fall of a sparrow. Finally, the fall always has its catcher in the rye or in the rocks, that which has a hidden attraction for the fallen and from which the next emergence appears. Eliot depicts the fall of every conscious moment in image of the soul as sailor, in a quote, in a drifting boat with a slow leakage, forever bailing. Here he depicts the fall in the impulse for coupling as part of the eternal rhythm of psychological life.
In that open field, if you do not come too close, if you do not come too close, on a summer midnight, you can hear the music of the weak pipe and the little drum, and see them dancing around the bonfire, the association of man and woman in dancing, signifying matrimony, a dignified and commodious sacrament. Two and two, necessary conjunction, holding each other by the hand or the arm which betokeneth concord. Round and round the fire, leaping through the flames or joined in circles, rustically solemn or in rustic laughter, lifting heavy feet in clumsy shoes, earth feet, loam feet, lifted in country mirth, mirth of those long since under earth, nourishing the corn, keeping time, keeping the rhythm in their dancing, as in their living in the living seasons, the time of the seasons and the constellations, the time of milking and the time of harvest, the time of the coupling of man and woman, and that of beasts, feet rising and falling, eating and drinking, dung and death.
In Giacomo Puccini's opera Tosca, the conniving, self-serving Scarpia, like Shakespeare's arch-villains Richard III and Macbeth, fallen into identification with the urge for power, sings an aria of exultation as he celebrates the triumph of his scheme, which will fulfill his appetites for both power and sex. He has tricked the object of his carnal drive, Tosca, into unwittingly revealing the whereabouts of her rebellious brother, political rival to Scarpia, enabling Scarpia to, at once, get rid of his nemesis and at the same time to manipulate Tosca into sacrificing her body to him. The aria takes the form of a black mass sung by an antichrist celebrating his earthly conquests in the midst of the spiritualized rituals of the church.
Sbirri, una carrozza, presto, seguila dovunque vada, non visto provvedi.
Sta bene, il convegno.
Palazzo Farnese. Scorpio!
certainly in light of the contemporary, that aria and that setting, in light of the contemporary scandals of pedophilic activity in the Catholic Church and in the Boy Scouts, resonates the archetypes and the myth at work in our scandals. The guide. The fall will often evoke the guide. The philosophical tree or world tree gives the symbolic sense of a transcendent quality to the world at hand. Roots descending downward to the underworld, branches extending upward to the heavens, and the central trunk of the middle world connecting the two. The ascending soul is stepping on the seventh rung of the ladder. Seven is the number of change, indicating a movement toward initiation, while the two priestly robed figures inject reflection into the scene. The bathing women are on a stage, a place of imagination itself as guide, unperturbed by the onlookers. The three-headed dragon, in colors of black and white on each side and red in the middle, all facing the same direction, gives a sense of the orientation to the project as a whole, the black indicating the suffering of deathly negredo, the white, the abstraction of silvery, reflective, imaginative albedo, and the red, the rubedo of worldly life. The sun in his chariot illuminates the scene, which includes everyday contests, as well as business deliberations, indicating that there is a guidance of some sort going on in every conscious moment, be it the game and its aim, or the course of ordinary conversation. The soul underway but disoriented is approached by a guide, often in the form of a surprise or a serpent, totally unexpected. The guide does not give directions so much as indications of a guiding presence, an other, encompassing spirit, a symbol of something with insight more than immediate consciousness. The guide can be the truth, the light, and the way, representing the persevering allegiance to the journey as necessity, or the devil in disguise. or the sociopath posturing as if there to help while in practice using us only for his own use. Misguiding us into dead ends, hopeless entanglements, endless labyrinths, wrong turns and disorientations, or a principle, or a fantasy, an idea, or the mad, leading the blind. T.S. Eliot, Dry Salvages. I sometimes wonder if that is what Krishna meant, among other things, or one way of putting the same thing, that the future is a faded song, a royal rose or a lavender spray of wistful regret for those who are not yet here to regret, pressed between yellow leaves of a book that has never been opened. You shall not think the past is finished or the future is before us. At nightfall in the rigging and the aerial is a voice decanting, though not to the ear, the murmuring shell of time, and not in any language. Fare forward, you who think that you are voyaging. You are not those who saw the harbor receding, or those who will disembark here between the hither and the further shore. While time is withdrawn, consider the future and the past with an equal mind. O voyagers, O seamen, you who come to port and you whose bodies will suffer the trial and judgment of the sea or whatever event this is your destination. So Krishna, as when the admonished Arjuna on the battlefield of, as when he admonished Arjuna on the field of battle, not farewell, but fare forward, voyagers. In a scene from Wagner's opera Tannhäuser, the appearance of a star through the dark night to a pilgrim takes on the aspect of the guide to the soul of a maiden accompanying the pilgrim, longing for her soulmate.
Yeah.
separation. The guide points to departure, separation from all that is known, all that is familiar, all that is certain. A departure, a leaving takes place. A leaving makes its way into the foreground. The separation is double, stepping out on foot, but focusing on the vase at hand, indicating a process taking place, the witnessing deer symbolizing the ever fugitive Mercurius. The vase is the vase, the container whose job it is to separate the process from the environment, the work at hand from the world, so that what needs to happen can happen in its own time and space. Separation involves ambivalence, conflict, conflict battle, and battle war, which is for Heraclitus, the father of all things. The sensibility of conflict is governed by the god of war, Ares, who rides in the chariot over the ibis, the water bird of Egyptian mythology, here differentiated into three heads, three directions. In alchemy, the composite coagulation at the beginning of the work, known as the prima materia, takes the form of the confused mass, the milky state of virginal being, the vaporous state of idealization, or the concretized, literalized quality of identification, calling for the splitting of the world egg, a separation of body and mind giving rise to space. Jesus evoked the sword, separating father from son, mother from daughter, a form of death to outdated, encrusted vision, skewed by cataracts and carbuncles. In chemistry, heat applied to matter brings about the restructuring of molecules through separation, resulting in a new order. The dark needs to be differentiated from the light, wheat distinguished from chaff, the yolk separated from the white, mind cut off from body, feeling from mind. Cleavage, cleavage, cleavage. Paradise needs distance. The rescue becomes aborted. Conflict is stirred up. The island splits off from the mainland. The stream is divided by the rock, the initiate from the community, self from other. All in the name of differentiation and discrimination. Separation is in the everyday leaving of the home, the child from school, for school, the worker for the office, as well as the departure from station, airport, and harbor, as well as the culture's felt need for protection, cornering itself in embargoes, abandoning treaties, literally walling itself in at the border while the actual enemy lies within. It is manifested in the overall tired and worn out state of relationship that calls for time out, estrangement, falling away, or divorce. She's got a ticket to ride, everything gone wrong in procession. Love itself slinking out the back door or storming out the front, lover slung across his shoulder. The danger always is that separation is an escape from that which we need to stick with, a loss of glue, a premature move for protection, ultimately uncalled for, something expelled that is simply not grasped, and the whole is lost for the part. Psychodynamically, separation can be seen in the dissociation from a rational conscious state. But this is also the separation that shamans create in their journey to the spirit world in service to healing. It also needs to be remembered that every separation becomes an attachment to a different form, at once a leave-taking and an arrival. Finally, of course, the great divide arises. The path opens to partition. You go your way, I go mine. The house collapses, departure up the tunnel to the light. This is where the cowboy rides away. T.S. Eliot, East Coker. In my beginning is my end. In succession, houses rise and fall, crumble, are extended, are removed, destroyed, restored, or in their place is an open field or a factory or a bypass. Old stone to new building, old timber to new fires, old fires to ashes and ashes to the earth, which is already flesh, fur, and feces, bone of man and beast, cornstalk and leaf. Houses live and die. There is a time for building and a time for living and for generation and a time for the wind to break the loosened pane and to shake the wainscot where the field mouse trots and to shake the tattered arras woven with the silent motto. Separation is paradoxically epitomized in the fundamental ritual of conjoining, the wedding. In order for the bride to be able to create a new life, she must suffer a form of death, like the mythological Kore, raped by Hades, and Iphigenia, sent to a sacrificial death in the form of a wedding, an enactment which brings about a change in vision, a new way of being. This ritual appears in Richard Wagner's opera, Die Walküre, when Wotan, king of the gods, condemns his favorite, but now disobedient warrior daughter, Brynhilde, to perpetual sleep on a mountaintop, separated from the world by a ring of fire, until awakened by a mortal who knows no fear. The aria Wotan's Departure tells of Wotan's suffering in letting go of his daughter, with whom he has spent many hours riding across the sky or rejoicing at the banquet table. She has been the laughing joy of his eyes, one now blinded, and he must kiss her eyes to sleep, a death to her life as divinity and its accompanying idealizing vision. The separation is necessary so that she may awaken to this perspective and vision engendered by the everyday life of mortality. This is the fate of all brides, male and female, to separate from the protected material world of the mother and the spiritual world of the father, and descend into the soul of complex human relationship, but ideally will carry the knowledge of being the joy in the father's eye. So now we're going to have two videos of the same aria. The first is focuses on this meeting, final meeting of father and daughter, and this whole, the camera does a tremendous job with the eyes of Brynhilde looking into the eyes of Wotan. And again, the idea here is that the sense of the daughter as the joy, the delight in the life of the father that the daughter carries with her into her life, separate life in the world. The second video emphasizes the imagery of fire as the separating wall of fire that is needed for the bride to come to the place where she can meet the appropriate bride.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yearning. Separation elicits yearning. The alchemical image of the Ethiopian indicates an emergence from a fallen state of blackness or negredo, and a reaching for a winged queen figure holding a red robe. We might say that the reach or yearning or desire itself, all indicative of a lack, is what makes the figure black. And there's nothing in the image to indicate a consummation. Rather, the suggestion of its ever receding possibility, as indicated by the deer moving out of the frame. A second image, again, contrasts dark to light, blackened foreground to golden distance. The sun on the horizon is personified, but the eyes of the face are, in turn, focused into the distance, as if the longing gaze of the yearning soul will always be met with a reciprocal gaze onward, indicating the ubiquitous, perpetuating nature of desire. In Gnostic mythology, separation brings about a kind of reversion of mind, a longing for a source to which the soul can be led back. The only paradise is the one that has been lost. Sophia, goddess of wisdom, lost in the center of the earth, slowly makes her way upward in return. Secondary phenomena suggest a primary pattern, preferable because it establishes the paradigm. Both Plato and Hesiod postulated a time of the golden age, when perfection ruled existence. Back to the good old days, the old time rock and roll. Get back, Jojo, get back to where you once belonged. Return with us now to those thrilling days of yesteryear. Back to the Reagan years. Make America great again. Try to remember that time in September. But turning back, glancing over the shoulder, always brings the danger of losing the follower, or its opposite, identifying with the loss and turning into the bitterness of a pillar of salt. The Greek word for this form of erotic pleasure is pathos. The never consummated desire for an object, or the longing desire for that which is not here and cannot be obtained. A derivative of pathos is nostos, the continuous nostalgic desire for homeland on the part of the wanderer. Pathos can also be seen as that state where the actual is never enough, and the eye is stuck in the past, the soul forever turning back to an imaginal loss, or failure, or a fuck-up, or a folly. The classic archetypal figure for this state is the puer, the eternal youth, pining away for the innocence and renewed possibility of a distant time and place. Yearning is mythically founded in the story of Orestes, who murdered his mother and was pursued by the Furies, who want vengeance for the blood of the mother. Ultimately, Athena, divinity of civilization, sets Orestes free, but grants a temple for the Furies, giving them a place. Or they will then have their place in the civilized world. Likewise, we might see the spirit of furious nationalism that we see today in the exclusion of others as the yearning of the mother blood of the tribe. Eliot imagines the past not as innocent nor as a matter of development, but the accumulated archetypal experience of generations looming behind or standing under. The past, then, is a subjectivity in itself, yearning for materialization in the present as it joins with the future.
It seems, as one becomes older, that the past has another pattern and ceases to be a mere sequence or even development. The latter a partial fallacy, encouraged by superficial notions of evolution, which becomes, in the popular mind, a means of disowning the past. The moments of happiness, not the sense of well-being, fruition, fulfillment, security or affection, or even a very good dinner, but the sudden illumination. We had the experience but missed the meaning, and approach to the meaning restores the experience in a different form, beyond any meaning we can assign to happiness. I have said before that the past experience revived in the meaning is not the experience of one life only, but of many generations. Not forgetting something that is probably quite ineffable, the backward look behind the assurance of recorded history, the backward half look over the shoulder toward the primitive terror. Now, we come to discover that the moments of agony, whether or not due to misunderstanding, having hoped for the wrong things or dreaded the wrong things is not in question, are likewise permanent, with such permanence as time has.
Come and cry there and twitter in the tree.
glitch. Crossing over. Yearning, paradoxically, evokes a turn onward, a turn onward toward the unknown. A knight straddles a two-sided fountain, one flowing with silver and the other with gold, resolutely facing beyond, sword raised in one hand, and in the other a red banner with inscription ending in make watery earth and multiply the stone, indications of paradoxical actions for transformation and proliferation. Above his head are seven stars, the number of initiation, a form of movement across boundaries. An hermaphrodite comes forth, an embodiment of an in-between space, signifying the initial emergent condition of a co-constituted state of old and new, known and unknown, concealed and revealed. Crossing over refers to the liminal place of change, the space between conditions of where I was and where I am going. It is the process of moving into a new world of assumptions, conditions, perceptions, understandings, and grounds of being. It is marked by ambivalence, pulling and pushing, feeling torn asunder, wavering and disorientation, as well as terror as initiation. It also evokes newfound resolution, commitment, and determination before finally tottering, stumbling, falling or schlepping, stepping, leaping forward with faith in the face of doubt, or collapsing in a pile. One grain of sand, one straw, too many. Yet, getting the toes wet may mean diving into a dry pool. Burning bridges result in isolation, while not burning bridges aborts the initiation. Crossing over signifies a phase transition in its ultimate sense, over, under, and across the water, and into the unknown, insecurity, uncertainty. Eliot, Burnt Norton. Descend lower, descend only into the world of perpetual solitude, world not world, but that which is not world, internal darkness, deprivation, and destitution of all property, desiccation of the world of sense, evacuation of the world of fancy, inoperation of the world of spirit. This is the one way, and the other is the same, not in movement, but abstention from movement, while the world moves in appetency on its metalled ways of time past and time future. In John Adams' opera, Dr. Atomic, Robert Oppenheimer finds himself on the cusp of plunging ahead with the development of the atom bomb, knowing full well its destructive potential. His words are from the sonnet by John Donne in the form of a prayer of supplication.
Battle!
Or through
We're a little bit more than halfway through. Let's take a 5-minute break. We'll be back in 5 minutes.
Well, greetings, everyone. Welcome back to the world that we are all inhabiting. Interesting presentation, and certainly I don't know the word for it, when you combine something, these different art forms and everything. Diane?
Transmedia.
Pardon me? Multimedia.
Transmedia.
Transmedia. I'm curious, Diane, what you know, with your deep relationship with the Splendor Solis, how a presentation like this resonates with you?
I always am fascinated by the very different ways that people experience the Splendor Solis.
Mm-hmm.
That because the images are intriguing and enigmatic and speak to different people in different ways. And so that's always been a fascination of mine. And I've known Ron for a while, though not well, and I know he's really different from me in the way that he approaches things. So that always interests me too, because I'm interested in how different people's minds work and how they respond to the same imagery or the same mythological material. So I was fascinated to see Wagner and John Adams. They're both operas I'm quite familiar with, and see those brought in. I never would have thought of that. So,
well,
yeah, what can I say?
I think it brings up the performance dimension of a lot of the material that we have. And I don't know if you were out here, you were always up in Northern California, I guess. But in the Southern California at the Getty, during the summer, they do pretty much classical and ancient Greek, like Euripides and Sophocles and what have you. And, you know, they do these plays, but they do them in a kind of an irreverent sort of way, like with like urban theater type people.
Mm-hmm.
It's fascinating to see what happens when we put a modern spin on some of these. I don't see the Splendor Solis as being ancient, but by our standards, it is certainly historical.
Yeah. And yet it's so easily projected upon.
Mm-hmm. Well, and this is why I think to put together some sort of a conference or a symposium would bring in not only the art, but the archetypes that are working in it, the developmental aspects of it. As you mentioned to me, it was originally woodcuts produced in black and white. And not.
Well, no, the woodcuts came later.
They did.
Yeah, they were later.
Color. So it was produced in color?
Well, I think that the color ones are based, were done probably by artists, by professional illuminators, but they must be based on a much earlier tradition, but they are much more sophisticated and subtle than the later woodcuts. Just like you see with the rosarium, I'd love to see some earlier versions of the rosarium. Mm-hmm. That before they did the woodcuts. But so many alchemical manuscripts were lost because they were not valued by the church. They really were in some ways compensatory to the culture, the main culture and the culture of the church. And so a lot of the manuscripts were lost. I'm hoping we'll still find some in rare libraries somewhere, you know.
Have you read the book by Stephen Greenblatt, The Swerve?
No, I haven't. I think I have it, but I haven't read the whole thing.
The story There was a pope, John the 21st, and he actually left office in quite disrepute. And his house calligrapher was a fellow named Poggio. And Poggio now found himself out of work. So he set off to all of the manuscript, all of the monasteries throughout Europe to find rare manuscripts. And in the course of it, he came upon Lucretius. And it's through Poggio's research into these monasteries that we know about Lucretius. Because these, and the story that Greenblatt writes about is such an adventure. I mean, it is a first class piece of scholarship. Mm-hmm. And he's primarily, Stephen Greenblatt is primarily a Shakespearean scholar, but he got a hold of this narrative, this tale. And it is fascinating to see what happened when a fellow turned his life around in response to the adversity he had been dealt by for the virtue of Pope John the 21st. And it wasn't until the recent Pope John the 21st that there for 500 years had been a Pope John 21st. So it was kind of, he was expunged. He was taken out of the history books. Mm-hmm. Nobody would touch his name until this other fellow came along just, 20, 30 years ago. So it's a fascinating story.
Oh, well, thanks for telling me.
I was curious, Diane, when you were talking about the coloring of the images, has there been any analysis of how different artists have used color values differently to express the meanings of the images?
Well, they're painted, the colors that they're painted are done in a typical medieval and Renaissance way where they use natural materials, the same ones that you find, they found in apothecary shops. But the color symbolism that's throughout the Splendor Solis is based on the making of cinnabar and the alchemical series of black, white, a brief yellow phase, and then red that are highly symbolic. And of course there's some beautiful blues. Yes. But if you think about the Ethiopian is actually painted as if he is the making of cinnabar. And cinnabar was mercuric sulfide, which was highly valued as a pigment and extremely beautiful. And it became a kind of symbolic transformation within alchemy. And you see it over and over again. So you have the negredo, the dark substance. Yes. Then what happens is when you combine the mercury and the sulfide, it takes on a white sheen. And then there's a brief yellow phase. And then it turns into cinnabar. And it's just, if you think about it, how magical that is, that that could happen. It just, they're in their senses and watching these things and experiencing it as a mirror of something going on internally. Mm-hmm. And using that to symbolize a profound process of their own beings being transformed. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, wonderful. Thank you so much.
Well, since you're mentioning cinnabar, I can't help but mention that in Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone, or Harry Potter's Philosopher's Stone, in that final, that sequence with Voldemort, the Philosopher's Stone is, mm-hmm. is a movie, it's a piece of cinnabar.
Yeah.
James Hillman, each of these colors that Diane is mm-hmm. mentioning has a whole complex, as she said, yes. a complex psychological meaning. If you're interested in pursuing that, the meaning of the black, not only the black, but the yellow, the white, the blue, the bluing, and the red, and so on. James Hillman has written all about that in his book on alchemical studies.
Yes, I've read that. It's wonderful. Okay. Great, thank you for that.
Okay. The goal. Crossing over engenders a focus on the overarching goal of the process. A peacock dwells in a vase, an image which indicates the goal of the work, in that the peacock's tail is representative of the many colors of the spectrum. One idea of the goal is the inclusion of everything as having its own place. Above the vase is a depiction of Venus and her son Eros, deities of connection in all its forms. Conjunction, the coming together of entities, is a goal of the work. How can I get it all to come together? The outer panels show scenes of daily life, connection, dialogue, kissing, taking in food and drink, playing instruments, singing and dancing. Three birds of black, red, and white intertwine. Black is the beginning position as well as the goal at the end of the line. The white of reflection and the red of action are brought together by, or even in conflict with, the presence of black. The scenes on the perimeter show actions and images of completion, a pile of gold, a king being crowned, scales in balance, reflection and action of the puffer going together, meditation and dialogue in harmony, the sniffing out of detail by the tracking and hunting dogs, all overarched by the king of the gods, Jupiter. The goal is a frame of mind, never actually attained. The last stop, the end of the line, Ixtlan, 24 hours to Tulsa, or the Emerald City. It is the small picture, every action having its own intention, as well as the big picture. When all is said and done, we ask the big questions. What are we really after? What is our mission? What is the mountain we are trying to climb? The direction in which we are oriented? Where is the glue uniting the disparity, the connection between self and other, the stillness that is the dance? In alchemy, the peacock is a symbol of the goal with its multiplicity of colors in its feathers. But in Hindu mythology, the peacock represents at once the feathers of an angel, the walk of a thief, and the voice of the devil. If any of you have ever heard peacocks call, you'll know what they meant by the voice of the devil. The goal can be the idealization, the good intention that leads to hell. For Eliot, the purpose ultimately is simply to embody life such that in the end, when one is dead and gone, it, the individual life, will fertilize the place, or in Eliot's words, nourish significant soil. In other words, we are not the heroes of our life we want to be or think we are. Rather, the best that we can do is to become good shit, to fertilize the right kind of soil in which something worthwhile, something else can germinate. In Eliot's words, for us, there is only the trying. The rest is not our business. Dry selvages. Here, the impossible union of spheres of existence is actual. Here, the past and future are conquered and reconciled. Where action were otherwise movement, of that which is only moved and has in it no source of movement, driven by demonic, chthonic powers, and right action is freedom from past and future also. For most of us, this is the aim, never here to be realized, who are only undefeated because we have gone on trying. We, content at the last, if our temporal reversion nourish, not too far from the yew tree, the life of significant soil. Finally, the goal is the realization that the process is the goal. The journey and the goal are one, and that the terminus is the beginning, as with the Zen herder, back again in the market with dusty bare feet, seeing the appearance of the original condition, the initial place, as Eliot says, as if for the first time.
I will make you brooches and toys for your delight of birdsong at morning and starshine at night.
Identification with the journey. At an unpredictable moment, striving ceases and the journey itself takes over. Inevitably, identification with the process takes over. Dwarfs dig at the sides of a mountain. Their focus is concentrated. They are one with the work itself. The process itself has taken over. Nothing else exists. Below, a boat with the face of the moon gazes upon them as the sun shines down. The scene reveals a path, a background storm, and the growth of lush vegetation. In the gallery below is a depiction of giving over to the process. The king is handing his scepter to the queen, symbolic of the biblical freeing of the Jews from persecution under the reign of Queen Esther. Women are hard at work in their washing with their linen spread out on the grass. We have arrived at the condition of solutio, the constant regurgitation of the spiral process. The same thing over and over again, each time around a little different. Each time a different dew from the moon is gathered. The image as a whole can be seen as signifying the process of working through. This is the time when a rhythm or flow is achieved, a system taking over, a stride hit, a game on, stabilization established, and at one with accomplished. It is the backstretch when the process takes on a self-organizing life of its own. No questioning, no doubting, no opposition or barrier, no self-consciousness, just being in it, all in. everything in service to old man time himself and the unveiling truth. The journey becomes a sojourn with no sense of conquest of time or space. Again, the danger is that in this repetition, meaning is lost. The forest is missed for the trees. The path has become a treadmill, a machinations co-opt, and the old man is simply a little man behind a curtain, turning wheels and pulling levers for effect. East Coker. Oh, dark, dark, dark. They all go into the dark, the vacant interstellar spaces, the vacant into the vacant, the captains, merchant bankers, eminent men of letters, the generous patrons of art, the statesmen, the rulers, distinguished civil servants, chairmen of many committees, industrial lords and petty contractors, all go into the dark. And dark the sun and moon and the Almanac de Gotha and the Stock Exchange Gazette, the directory of directors, and cold the sense and lost the motive of action. And we all go with them into the silent funeral, nobody's funeral, for there is no one to bury. Dry salvages. Where is the end of them? The fishermen sailing into the wind's tail where the fog cowers. We cannot think of a time that is oceanless, or of an ocean not littered with wastage, or of a future that is not liable, like the past, to have no destination. We have to think of them as forever bailing, setting and hauling while the northeast lowers over shallow banks, unchanging and erosionless, or drawing their money, drying sails at dockage, not as making a trip that will be unpayable for a haul that will not bear examination.
Pleasure's a sailing. seems but a boyish stare, and his face is gone.
Sacrifice. Identification eventually requires sacrifice. A new king, a new way of life, mindset, or attitude appears in conjunction with the helpless drowning of the old in the background. The text reads, "They further saw the king of the earth sink and heard him cry out with eager voice, 'Whoever saves me shall live and reign with me forever in my brightness on my royal throne.' And night enveloped all things. The day after, they saw over the king an apparent morning star, and the light of day cleared up in the darkness. The king of the earth was released and renewed. A dark executioner stands with a severed head over the dismembered body. In the background is an entrance into a timinos, or sacred space, and a crossing over. The text runs, "I have killed thee that thou mayest receive a superabundant life, but thy head I will carefully hide, that the worldly wanton may not find thee and destroy the earth, and the body I will bury, that it may purify, putrefy, and grow and bear innumerable fruit." Sacrifice is the psychological realm of necessary, often terrifying loss of that which is valued. Something has to be given up. The only child, the father's daughter, the mother's son lover, a relationship, a favored animal, a pile of gold, the ring of power, a precious stone, a traditional principle, or it can even be alcohol or a favorite food, a habit or a dysfunctional learned attitude or behavior pattern, a fear or a depression. All sacred, all have to be given over, the old king worn out, thrown over to the wolf, for a new attitude to arise, new order to take place, healing to occur, fresh crops to germinate, renewal to take place. Something needs to suffer burnout, something flooded and overwhelmed, the head shaved, the skin flayed, the torture laid bare for a new evocation or call to be heard. Politically speaking, sacrifice is the loss of the favored candidate, making room for an unforeseen evolution. In terms of cultural psychology, the plague or the pandemic can be seen as a sacrifice. The current giving over the current matrix and atmosphere and matrix of assumptions and expectations that we live by. Yet, just as the gods have needs for mortals, and mortals may fulfill these needs through sacrifice, the result may only be to have the gods turn their backs. The new king, the new way of life and thinking, the new modality turns out to be a bad fit, or just plain wrong. The necessary loss giving rise to something worse or nothing new. No redemption at hand. Finally, sacrifice may eventually be identified with and entrenched as martyrdom ensues, benefiting nothing and no one, leading to stagnation.
The wounded surgeon plies the steel that questions the distempered part. Beneath the bleeding hands, we feel the sharp compassion of the healer's art, resolving the enigma of the fever chart. Our only health is a disease if we obey the dying nurse, whose constant care is not to please, but to remind of our and Adam's curse, and that to be restored our sickness must grow worse. The whole earth is our hospital, endowed by the ruined millionaire, wherein, if we do well, we shall die of the absolute paternal care that will not leave us, but prevents us everywhere. The chill ascends from feet to knees, the fever sings in mental wires. If to be warm, then I must freeze and quake in frigid purgatorial fires, of which the flame is roses and the smoke is briars. The dripping blood, our only drink, the bloody flesh, our only food, in spite of which we like to think that we are sound, substantial flesh and blood. Again, in spite of that, we call this Friday good.
Thank you.
Glitch, just a second. Release. With a new, unknown horizon imminent, a release is evoked. The bath is release, the tub provides the container for letting go, and the water indicates a form of salutio, or breaking up of patterns housed in the weary body. The white dove on the head of the bather suggests a kind of grace, as if a form of baptism or washing away of impurities is taking place. The vase with yellow gaseous substance represents a vaporous sublimation or ethereal movement upward. Intricately connected to the passive sinking in, there is an active blowing of the billows below. Letting go induces a heating up of the situation. The domed structure above indicates a temple or sacred space paralleling the tub, container of waters. Release is play, reflecting Jesus' statement, except ye be converted and become as little children, you shall not enter into the kingdom. Or Nietzsche's final stage in the evolution of the soul. Children at play represent the mode of play for play's sake, ironically, part of the opus or work that comes about of its own accord. Nothing is more serious than play, and nothing more playful than the serious. The text of the Splendor Solis reads, "Wherefore is this art compared to the play of children who, when they play, turn undermost that which is uppermost." Today we call that deconstruction. The play of children turns things on their head. providing a completely new imaginative perspective. And it is always already right there at hand, like Eliot's voices of children concealed in the foliage, laughing. Release is that part of the process where all expectations and assumptions regarding the journey are unhanded. Orgasm achieved, but also the sudden sob of repressed emotion. Modes of being, styles of consciousness, all have served their purpose, and an awful daring of a moment's surrender comes about, a giving over to something larger than, letting it to take its own course. A kind of decay is taking place, governed by a pulsating rhythm, a gradual approach to collapse, followed by a pullback, and then another approach until the last thread of attachment is released with a final gasp, the last string broken. I quit. The emotional tone can be either one of calm at the center of the storm, the hush between the lightning and the thunder, or one of terror of the unknown as if set adrift, the timing precisely right or premature, the throwing up of hands too soon, missing the potential. Ultimately, it is in the place of giving over to the loss where the discovery is made, where the caught fish returns to the sea, letting go as Islam, the surrender to a greater power, to the demon of one's personal fate, or to one's God. Whither you go, I will go. All the days of my life, I will dwell in the house. Little Gidding.
Ash on an old man's sleeve is all the ash the burnt roses leave. Dust in the air suspended marks the place where a story ended. Dust inbreathed was a house, the wall, the wainscot, and the mouse. The death of hope and despair, this is the death of air. There are flood and drought over the eyes and in the mouth, dead water and dead sand contending for the upper hand. The parched, eviscerate soil gapes at the vanity of toil, laughs without mirth. This is the death of earth. Water and fire succeed the town, the pasture, and the weed. Water and fire deride the sacrifice that we denied. Water and fire shall rot the marred foundations we forgot of sanctuary and choir.
This is the death of water and fire. Gerald Finzi sets to music a speech from Shakespeare to a headless corpse that is, in fact, misidentified by the speaker, indicating the complexity of release and its timing, all dependent upon situation and perspective.
Take my wages, the gold. flesh. No, the old dreaded thunderstorm. Fear not, slander, censure.
Emergence. A young queen contained in a vase stands on a depiction of a male head. The vase is surrounded by an urban scene of various modes of creative endeavor well underway. Organ playing, scholarly writing, street bartering, sculpting. The creativity of the city appears, and the queen can be imagined as a form of muse inspiring this emergence. Something different is coming forth. Governing the scene is Hermes, Mercurius, god of inspiration. A new king appears, ornamented in red, and the panel below is in red. Rubedo, the color of the final alchemical stage, action within the world. On the side panels are images of hunting and fishing, as well as women washing. The hunting and fishing signify a relationship to nature that, in a way, works against nature, the counter movement to natural flow that rubs up against, through which a new condition can be achieved. Above the scene is Luna, goddess of the moon, and her changing forms. In Gnostic mythology, emergence is the soul recognizing its essential nature, which includes a spark of the divine, indicating the unity of being. We might interpret this psychologically as the essentially interactive nature of the psyche in everyday life. There is always something of us in the presence of the other and something of the other in us. We are always in a state of emergency. All perception, all interpretations, all feeling, all memory, every moment of consciousness becomes an emergent phenomenon arising from an interaction with the world. The psychological task is not so much one of overt action, but of active reflection. Then the wheel turns, and the renewing work of integrating this realization, this reawakening, begins all over. In the science of complexity theory, all systems universally, from those at the level of subatomic particles to the astronomical systems of the universe with its billions of galaxies, from the individual psyche to social systems such as cities, emergence is that third world of adaptation which characterizes the interaction and interpenetration of systems and their resulting form, their resulting unpredictable form. In alchemy, it is the constant interaction of elements and the interaction of alchemists with matter from which transformation of form emerges. No longer can we isolate an individual agency as cause, bringing about effect. Rather, what we are affected by is always an emergent co-creation of multiple systems, including ourselves. Emergence can refer to phenomena like the birth of a star, an economic meltdown, or global warning, or the emergence of a megalomaniac. Reflecting the values, the concealed predominant values of the culture from which he emerges. Or it can be a traffic jam, a volcano erupting, a political upheaval, the stomach regurgitating, or a new idea or relationship blossoming or falling apart. The perceived threat in our midst, or merely the annoyance, the turn to purple of the wild iris in its death. So just a note here on the political situation, on the political scene. We tend to see fall of Trump as and say, oh good, we're done. But what we don't see is the idea that Trump is a symbol of the culture from which he emerges. We're not done with Trump. What about these over 70 million people that voted for him? What about the 130 representatives that voted against having Biden the votes count for him for president? It's in Trump is an emergence of a preconcealed predominant values in our culture that we don't want to face. The misogyny, the not wanting people to come in, strangers to come in, the sense of arrogance within the world. All of that we despise in Trump is really in our culture. It's the way our culture operates in a predominantly, but we don't want to say that. We want to stick to the received values of equality of opportunity and so on and so on, democracy. We're not a democracy, we're an aristocracy, and run by masters of the economy. Little Gidding. We shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time through the unknown remembered gate, when the last of earth left to discover is that which was the beginning. At the source of the longest river, the voice of the hidden waterfall and the children in the apple tree, not known, because not looked for, but but heard, half heard in the stillness between two waves of the sea. Quick, now, here, now, always, a condition of complete simplicity, costing not less than everything. And all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, when the tongues of flame are enfolded into the crowned knot of fire, and the fire and the rose are one. The Neoplatonic voice depicts beauty with a capital B as a force streaming through the universe, which allows for the appearance and being of all things, and in return receives the gratitude of the world as it circles back to the source. Eliot again has the last word. At the still point of the turning world, at the still point, there the dance is. Except for the point, the still point, there would be no dance, and there is only the dance.
Let beauty awaken the morn from beautiful dreams, beauty awake from rest. Let beauty awake for beauty's sake, in the hour when the birds awake in the brake, when the stars are bright.
Thank you.
What an interesting treatment. And I love the art. I love the sculpture. I love the Matisse at the end. You know, I haven't really experienced anything like that, Ron. I'm really grateful for your adventurous spirit. And I will say, you know, as long as it is, you really were quite successful in holding on to a big piece of the audience, you know, and you're, now when you do this live, you sing those parts?
Yes.
Wow.
Wow, you have a breadth of talent, you know.
I didn't say that.
Yeah,
I just said
do.
I do.
You do.
The idea is not having talent and, you know, doing a performance. The idea is kind of being the conduct, like the Navajo singer, you know, conducting the whole thing. That's the point.
Well, I do a lot of conducting of this sort of thing, but boy, you won't catch me singing in front of a crowd. Oh, I'd love to hear again, Diane. I was thrilled when you said yes to this. It's sort of my latest mantra up here. But I'm curious what you how share with us any of your reactions.
Wow. Well, Ron, my favorite part was when you were reading your own written dialogue and the way you put words together and expressions and the cadence in your voice, the soft cadence of your voice was provocative and comforting at the same time and very easy to listen to and stimulating to my unconscious and my mind, the connections that you made. So in a way, that was my favorite part of what you did. And I actually have a question for Ron. I was a little puzzled that you chose so much German music to go with this particular material, and rather than perhaps something medieval to do with alchemy or
let's see, you're frozen now,
Eliot, you know. So I'm really curious about that.
You know, I was struck by this. You all know that I've been working on this project with the Tao Te Ching, of how much Tao Te Ching is in T.S. Eliot and in the Splendor Solis as Ron has interpreted it. You know, the opposition, the space between the waves and all of the kinds of the things. I mean, the language is really in there. I hadn't really made that connection before, but I just see so much potential for more material of deepening our exposure and relationship with the Splendor Solis and even with you, Diane. I would love to invite you back and, you know, talk more.
I'm sure we're not going to get through enough conversation.
But Diane, you don't have to sing. It would be okay, unless you like to sing. I would also, you know, my good friend Sophie is above you on my screen, and I introduced her to the Splendor Solis, or at least she credits me with that. I don't know whether it's true or not. But then she was thrilled when you were coming on here. She said, first you introduced me and now you're bringing the author, and you know, but I would just like to give her a moment if she'd like to say anything to you.
Oh, sure. Hi, Diane. So nice to see you. Yeah, I'm a big fan of your book. It really helped me dive into each of the images of the Splendor Solis and really get into all the symbolism. And thank you for that.
Oh, you're very welcome. Joseph Henderson and I tried to write the book as a kind of a way into the images and how we were working with them at that particular time, rather than trying to be encyclopedic in some way, like so that people would have like a way in and then could have their own experience and develop that more. I just really appreciated what you said, and I hope that you will make, in a way, make the material your own, you know? We weren't trying to be authorities. We were trying to share our experience of the material and the research that I had done on it.
Yeah, absolutely. Actually, since then, I found another source that's completely different, but it spoke to me because I know you presented me as an artist, but originally I studied engineering and did mechanical engineering and then 2 degrees in applied mathematics. So I'm still very much a mathematician at heart, and this book was written by a mathematician on alchemy. It's actually the complete idiot guide to alchemy.
Oh.
And it's written really well. It goes into the principles. It really explains like the sulfur and the mercury, mm-hmm. and not just like the metals, but spiritually, and then how that brings on the salt. So there's really the 3 components. And so the 3, 4, and 2, the 4 elements. So the 3 component generates the 4, who then generates the 7 planetary operations. So all of this. So now I look at the images with that in mind, mm-hmm. and I'm seeing new things that I would not seen.
That's great. I mean, because that's one set of alchemical versions, what you're talking about. you know, it's like it wasn't a coherent, necessarily a coherent body of work. But that's wonderful if that like opens up something more imaginatively for you too.
Yeah, it's like the night of the double fountain.
How you see it.
Well, just take the night of the double fountain image. Now, I just realized today, you know, after meditating on it for a while, that it has the whole, every process is described in that one image. So it's got the sulfury and the sulfur and the mercury. It has the night is the body, the salt. That means it really says the process is happening in the body. And then you have the four operation on the chest.
Yeah.
And then the seven star is like the planetary. That's the spiritual process that's happening there. So it's like the whole thing is described in one image.
Yeah. Yeah. But it's the image. It's like the whole thing is always there, but it's different. It's at a different point, even though it's always there. Which brings up Eliot in a way, you know?
Yeah.
Because the night is, it's like he has a resolve to do something. It's like that ego strength that you are going to really follow through on this process.
Yeah, I can see that.
And bridging the opposites.
Yes, yes, through that process. So that's he's straddling both.
Yeah, but you know it's an initiatory experience because of the stars.
Yeah.
And over his heart are the four colors. It's like he's really taken all this to heart, and it's he's not just thinking about it or a soldier. He's really going to change here.
Yes. Yeah, and then so did Eliot, you know, and Eliot, the way he split it in the four elements, air, earth, water, fire, I started reading about the poems on Wikipedia, and like the four are linked to different locations. Like the first one was a manor, like those are like two houses that he's visited, and then the third one is linked to a place, like the water is linked to a place in Massachusetts that he visited as a boy. And so he's got these connections, but I find like the first two are personal, the two last ones are more like collective. Like the last one is a church community, it's not even a place, but it does a description of the mind, the body, the environment, and then God. It's like the same thing as with the Splendor Solis.
Oh, that's beautiful. Well, I'd love to, if you have more to say about it or you're writing about it, I'd love to know about it.
Well, we will share, if you're willing, Diane, I can circulate your email address among the panelists. And I am just really touched again. And I know it's late back there. Aren't you 3 hours late or are you 2 hours late?
Three. It's a little after 11 for me.
A little after 11. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, I started at 7 this morning. So
wow.
It's time for me.
So let me bring it back to Ron's performance tonight. And I know that our other panelists, Selena, Zaman, and Connie, would jump in. But this is good food for thought for the next time, that I think that if I can persuade you to come in and do a myth salon on the Splendor Solis, that I could probably persuade Ron to come back as a guest panelist for us, you know, to really stimulate the rich discussion that is possible. But Ron, I would like to throw it to you one time and just provide us with just a little insight about what drew you to the Splendor Solis the first time and how you came up to do this. And then let's give people a few just thoughts about it, because it's an inspirational thing. When I started going myself to Diane's workshop in 2004, I bought her book the moment it came out, but I'd known about the Splendor Solis for probably, I don't know, 8 years before that. And there's just not a whole lot of text material out there. And I can refer you, but the Moyero publication that Jörg Vollnagel has developed all the commentaries for. I mean, these are beautiful, beautiful sets. There's 22 of these illustrations. I'll call them illustrations. They're not really illuminations, but what drew you to it, Ron? Tell me, you know, what got you going to construct this piece that you delivered tonight?
Well, first I want to answer Diane's question about the German music. There, I included three arias from Wagner, and there's several reasons for that. One is that the whole thing is, as I said in the beginning, is kind of inspired by Wagner's. I grew up on Wagner, by the way, and so it's hard for me to keep Wagner out of anything that I do. But what was I going to say? Oh yeah, Wagner's sense of the total theater is one of the inspirations for this presentation. The idea, Wagner's idea of bringing everything into the theatrical event, into the operatic event, music, literature, philosophy, you know, everything. So that's one reason. The second reason is that Wagner is very mythical, and so the myths that the myths that are informing his operas are very much in line with the themes in them. I saw as being very much in line with the themes in the Splendor Solis. The dramatic quality of these scenes and these arias, I wanted to bring in just like the Italian one of Tosca, you know, to kind of give a dramatic sense of the archetypal condition as well as the everyday sense of it. In other words, to give a sense that in the everyday, there is something really dramatic going on as well. So most of the songs were from were English art songs, Finzi and Ray Vaughan Williams, and sung by Bryn Terfel from a CD called The Vagabond. So the entire CD is about a journey. And I just love the songs. And again, they really just blended in with the conditions there. To answer your question, Dana, I'm very much taken personally and professionally with the myth, the Gnostic myth of the soul and its journey. And Jung was too. Jung pointed me to the Gnostic myth. And then I started doing research into the different themes in the Gnostic myth, and the paradoxes involved in the Gnostic myth. The idea that you have this journey of getting to someplace, getting to a goal, and when you get to the goal, you find out that you've been there all the time. That is just a very simplistic way of looking at it, and a simplistic way of looking at the technical traditional Gnostic myth, which is that the soul finds its spiritual component, which I think was very influential, influenced Jung a great deal. So that's the answer to your question.
Well, thank you. Thank you very, very much. And you are so generous and evocative in your spirit. What an interesting myth salon. So, as much as we've had voice tonight, which is what I do, I'm going to take us out with a moment of silence. And I want us just to give a moment for those who can't be here for a variety of reasons. Just put them into our hearts and minds, and let's be one with that. All right. Thank you all. Thank you very much for what a wonderful long evening. This is the longest Miss Salon we've had. And you held it up. You did well, Ron. Thank you very Thank you. Much. Thank you, Will. Thank you.
Diane, you look a lot more fresher than I do, and you've been up longer than I have.
Diane, you were great. Saman, Selena.
Thank you.
To the other panelists that had other commitments and had to go and couldn't stay. This has been a great evening. And
it'll be really cool recorded, and we've recorded it. It'll be really cool to share. Yeah. The
nice thing is you can fit it all on a single digital file. It's not like you had to use two VHS tapes or two CDs anymore.
Here's a word for those who live in LA, that the LA Jung Society is planning to have this in its live aspect. So that's down the line if you're
interested. Well, everyone know. All right, people.
Okay. Take care.
Good evening.